Welcome, welcome. My name is Pastor Micah Tyler. I'm the Creative Arts Pastor here, and I want to welcome you here. If it's your first time here, please feel like a guest, an honored guest, but we hope that you move to the point of family, because we're all kind of like a big family here. Look at the person beside you and say, "You family." And families fight sometimes, right? But in general, we just love each other, right? So that's good. I want to, of course, welcome our folks hanging out in the lounge right now, our Life Springers. Hey, babe, can you push that door open? I want to hear Life Springs for a second. So Life Springs lounge people, I want you to shout as loud as you can. We want to hear you in here. So on the count of three, I want you guys to shout it out just so they believe that you guys are in there. So in 3, 2, 1... That's what I'm talking about. That's what I'm talking about. And they want to hear you guys, so let's give them a shout. Leave those doors open in 1, 2, 3. You guys are definitely louder. And of course, if you're in the party room, we love you guys. And our online guests, of course, we love you. Thanks for tuning in there. And I hope you have an opportunity to get here and check out the service here. It's a lot of fun. Of course, a little about me. If you haven't met me before, I am an old man. And I am expecting another kid now. And my wife, we got 6 weeks to go before our next little pork chop comes along. His name is Ezra Michael. Yeah, and so there's my wife back there, the hot blonde right there holding the little pork chop, and that's Liam. Hi, Liam. You want to say hi? I can't blame you. All right, cool. So awesome. We're glad you're here, and we want you to be to feel welcome. A couple quick things. Jen mentioned the announcement, the open house is coming out. On your way out, I'm going to give you, we're going to grab some of these invite cards. And the top invite card is unique because it's a little invite to open house. So what open house is, it's a great way to bring a friend, and they can kind of get to know the church before they really get into the church. And so they're going to, it's going to be food in the lounge. I think Katrina's probably doing the food there. So they're going to have food and some testimonies and things like that, meet Pastor Dale kind of thing. So it's a great way to come. I want you guys all to come to this open house on Thursday. And of course, if you come, that means you will have brought somebody with you, because we're not allowed to go if we don't bring somebody. So I'm not even allowed in there unless I bring somebody. So you may or may not see me there if I can commit someone to come with me. The rest of the cards are for our next series called Winning. So these are great. If you could pass them around town or whatever like that, put them on a, attach $5 to them and stick them on a gas pump or something like that. Get creative. Bake a plate of cookies for your neighbor and stick a little card in there. Get creative and invite somebody to church. Last thing I'll say, and then we'll get started here. If you're here and you don't know Jesus Christ, it's okay. We're not a club of Christians here. We're just a bunch of people that like to hang out together on the weekend and start talking about God and thinking about God. So if you're here and you don't know Christ, that is totally fine. There's going to be a lot in this message that is just for Christians, but there's tons of it that is for everybody. And so I want to challenge you today to lean in. There's a lot of good stuff going on. So at Stanley Chapel and Life Springs Church, we like to text and tweet. How many of y'all were on Facebook this morning already? How many of y'all posted something already? Who are the people that like post? I mean, you go on their Facebook page or something, and they have like 16 posts in like 20 minutes. Anybody in here guilty of that? Oh, people are pointing to their wives over there. That might be true. Yeah. Anyway, so if you're a good poster, we like to give you a little something to post, because you all got somebody that's at home in their underwear right now, probably scrolling around on Facebook, and they ought to be in church. Amen. So let's give them a little sample of church here. This is a little social media moment. You can take a picture of it. You can even come up here and take a picture if you're not shy. Or you can just type it out if you're good old-fashioned. You could talk it to Siri here. Here we go. It says, "The problem with thinking that God wants good people to go to heaven and bad people to go to hell," because a lot of people think that, I believe, "is that there are," this goes in your blank, in your outline, "there are no good people." Ouch. Start strong here. So the problem with thinking that God wants good people to go to heaven and bad people to go to hell is that there are no good people. And we're going to talk about that today. Good. All right. So To kick off here, we're in this is the last leg of a series called "The Struggle Is Real." How many of y'all have struggles? Anybody struggle besides me? Yeah, we all have different kinds of struggles. A lot of times we're struggling against ourselves, trying to get motivated to do this better or whatever. And so I was thinking about, like, what are some other struggles? What are some things that we think we can do, and then we get into it, and then it's just not happening. And I looked this up. They say it's almost impossible to lick your elbow. Who wants to try? Come on. I'll do it with you. I'm close, but it's not happening. Anybody lick their elbow? I see an elbow licker back there. All right, so we got a few elbow lickers, but it's one of those things. There's another one that says, you cannot swing your leg clockwise and draw a 6 at the same time. I don't know. I'm going to try it at home, but some of y'all are going to be trying that while I'm speaking, and that's not good. But if you swing your leg clockwise and draw a 6, and they say that's impossible. I'm going to give you something else that I like to get people out of their seat. I like to get you kind of loosened up here. So we're going to try something here, if we may. Shane, are you ready? All right, come on up here, Shane. We're going to show them how to do it first. All right, so this is a good old-fashioned tent pole. And we're going to try a little activity here, and we're going to do it down the rows. So if you're on the end or whatever, or if you just want to be ambitious and stand up, we're going to try this thing out. They say it's nearly impossible, but what I'm going to have you do is you're going to line up on either side of the pole, just kind of spaced out. So Shane's going to be in that side. Here we go. And so we're going to have maybe 10 or 15, as many people want to be in it. And then you're going to put your finger on it. Just turn your finger sideways. You can't curl your finger around it or have another finger over anything. Just turn it sideways like that. And all you have to do is lower this all the way to the ground. Okay? That was easy, right? Now, 10 or 15 people, the only rule is you cannot pick your finger up off the stake, or you have to start over. So we're going to start about shoulder, eye level, something like that, and we'll bring it down. But if my finger comes off of there at all, or if anybody's finger comes off of it at all, we got to start over. Okay? So y'all want to try this? Can we do this real quick? I want to see if this is actually possible. So we're going to go down this row. Come on, some people. Just grab that. Get out there, Justice. Come on. I know you want to. And some people, here you go, Austin. Let's make this happen here. So maybe get a few people on either side of it. Come on. Don't be shy. We're all family here. We're friends. Come on. There you go. There you go. Come on, Chautauqua. Come on, Kevin. Let's go. Come on, Maggie. You can do it. It's as easy as sticking your finger out. So I'm going to watch for cheaters here. I'm watching for cheaters. All right. We'll start about shoulder level or eye level for some. Right, Kristen? Okay, and Maggie, keep your finger flat, keep it level. So pick your hand up so your finger's level. There you go. Fingers level, all right. And on the count of three, you guys can start at shoulder level, okay? But if your finger leaves it at all, we gotta start over. So here we go, let's lower it all the way to the ground and the count of three, and 3, 2, 1, let's lower it. If your finger leaves it at all, then we got to start over. Keep it flat. Everybody go down together. When you're ready, go ahead. When you're ready. Okay. Try to keep your finger flat. Keep your finger flat, not angled. There you go, Chautauqua. Mm-hmm. There you go. I know it's pretty high up there for you. But. Okay. When you're ready, go ahead. I see it's a little unbalanced here. There you go. Come on. Keep it flat there, Genevieve. I see you cheating. There you go. There you go. Young lady on the end. Okay, all the way to the ground. Come on, just lower it down to the ground. If your finger leaves, you got to start over. If anybody's finger comes off of it, you got to start over. Go ahead, all the way to the ground. Come on, what are you waiting for? We'll give you another 30 seconds. Here we go. All the way to the ground. Anybody's finger leave it yet? Okay, come on. Keep it flat. How low can you go? All the way to the ground. Come on. All right, this is a little... Is this weird, guys? Is this... All right, 10 seconds. 9, 8, 7, 6. I see fingers coming off there. 3, 2, 1. All right, good job. Give them a hand for attempting something that is actually nearly impossible. And it's kind of weird that that would be impossible or near impossible. It took a group of teenagers like 15 minutes or something like that to get that all the way to the ground. So I think they just got tired and eventually their arms dropped together. But that is something that looks like it would be easy, but it's actually pretty complicated, actually difficult. There's a lot of things in life that we kind of approach it and say, all right, this is going to be easy. I got this. I can do this. And then we get into it and we're like, oh man, I actually messed this up. I need to start over. Maybe I just needed to try harder, right? How many of y'all had some New Year's resolutions for this past year? Anybody do New Year's resolutions anymore? A lot of y'all gave up on New Year's resolution. My resolution this year is to come up with some New Year's resolutions because I think we all give up on them. Why? Because about 2 weeks in, what happens? Well, I'm going to stop drinking this year and it's open bar at this wedding. Let's do that next year. All right. You know what I mean? Or I'm going to start this diet. It's going to be great. Some Sanders donuts. Come on now. That has broken too many New Year's resolutions. But this is a consistent human experience. We all kind of start with these great intentions. We're going to do this better. We're going to stop doing this thing. We're not going to go back to that old relationship that keeps bringing us down. But then there's something inside of us that just, we're almost like we're fighting ourselves. Anybody else feel like you're fighting yourself sometimes, right? We get in these battles with ourselves. And I want to talk about why that might be today. So the struggle is totally real. And there's this great guy in the Bible named Paul. You ever heard of him, Paul? And Paul, Paul wrote a whole bunch of the Bible. And he talks about his struggle. And I think when you hear his words, it's going to be one of those things like, yeah, that's me. That's written for me today. So I hope that you hear this. We're going to be reading out of Romans chapter 8. And let me tell you just a little bit about Romans. Romans is like a lot of people say this is like the best book in the whole Bible. I don't know how you pick a best, but if the Bible was like a ring, it would be like the center stone is Romans, right? And if you were to pick like the best chapter out of Romans, you might pick chapter 8, which is what we're going to be talking about today. So if today you're like, I don't really like reading the Bible. I don't want to read the Bible. Maybe you could start in Romans and kind of get a feel for what I'm talking about here. This is an awesome book. It's super deep. There's a lot of times I've read it and I'm like, I have no idea what I just read. I might as well go start over, right? I got to read it two or three times even to get anything out of it. So today we're going to be talking about that. Now, Paul is writing to Rome. That's why it's called Romans, right? And let me tell you about Rome at the time. Rome is like the epicenter of culture for that time, right? It's like the New York City of the ancient world where everything, they set the trends for style, for thoughts and beliefs, all those things. And so they're very influential culture. So he's writing to them. And so Paul is very meticulous to explain Christianity to the Romans because if he does it right there, it'll spread throughout the world. So that's the whole point here. And he succeeds in doing that in a lot of ways. So we're going to start actually in Romans 7 to kind of set up where we're going here today. So I got it. The verses should be behind me up here and in your outline so you can kind of read along with me. But let's read this together. Romans 7, 15 through 19 says, I do not understand what I do. For what I want to do, I do not do. But what I hate, I do. Right? Paul, if I could summarize this, he's saying, what is wrong with me? Right? Anybody else been there? What is wrong with me? And this is common to everybody. For instance, I was getting ready for this message, and Thursday I was headed to church about 7:30 in the morning, and I get out to the end of the development to turn left, okay? And I'm getting ready to turn left, and there's a truck coming this way, and I say, all right, is he going to turn into this development, or is he going on? Because I got to know if I should make a move or should just wait for him. And he starts slowing down. I was like, come on, dude, you know, just use your turn signal already. Do you guys know what that is? A turn signal? I don't even know if they make them down here, turn signals. And I'm a little bit critical of turn signals. I was like, dude, come on, just use your turn signal. And then I looked down at my dashboard. I wasn't using my turn signal, and I was about to turn left out of my thing, so he didn't even know where I was going. So it's the kind of thing like, I feel like you shouldn't be doing that, but then I look at myself and like, why do I do that, you know? And there's something common to us all, that we act in ways that we think no one else should act, right? We're watching things. Man, I would not recommend this for my kids or for anybody else. I really don't think anybody should be greedy. But man, there's something inside of me that wants more and more and more. Or I don't think anybody should lust after someone that is not their wife or their husband. But man, there's something in me that wants to lust after someone else, right? Whether it's an image or an actual person or whatever. And we act in ways that nobody should act. We don't think anyone should act. And that's what Paul is saying. This is common to everybody. And it continues, verse 16. It says, if I do what I do not want to do, I agree that the law is good. Okay, now what this law he's talking about, we're going to break it down in a little bit. But the law he's talking about is God's law. A lot of y'all say, well, there's so many rules in the Bible. But if you're fighting yourself to do the right thing, you're just basically saying that the law is good. It's necessary because I can't even obey. I can't even try hard enough and keep things good. So, but we'll talk about that law in just a second. As it is no longer I myself who do it, but it is sin living in me. For I know that good itself does not dwell in me, that is my sinful nature, for I have the desire to do what is good, but I cannot carry it out, right? How many of y'all have really good intentions, but then when it comes time to actually make it happen, man, there is something we're fighting. It's like we're fighting inside of ourselves, right? It says, for I do not do the good I want to do, but the evil I do not want to do, this I keep on doing. This is the struggle right here. This is the struggle common to humanity, right? This is the struggle is definitely real. And this is totally familiar because in all of our problems, and no matter what your problem, no matter what your struggle is, there is a unique problem for each one of us. You know what that problem is? My problem is different than your problem because guess what your problem is? Your problem is you. My problem is me. This goes in your blank. This is our first problem. The problem that we all have, this struggle, is ourselves. We're fighting ourselves. The problem is you. Your problem is you. My problem is me. My wife's problem is probably me too. But for the rest of us, the problem is ourselves. I love my dear wife. She was so sweet the other day. She says, babe, you know, we've been married for coming on 4 years now, and it's felt like 10 minutes underwater. Come on, babe. Come on. Struggle. All right. Anyway, that has nothing to do with anything. All right. So your problem is you, and to understand that there's almost like two parts of yourself that are fighting out a war, right? And I think this is where they get this concept of yin and yang and the good and bad fighting, because there's something inside of us that has the desire to do good, but then there's also this like sinful nature that we're fighting against, and those two things are fighting. And I think there's a myth. There's a common myth out there that people are inherently good. We're all good people, right? Everybody here good people? Y'all know some good people, right? We're all good people, right? That's good enough. But we all have this sin nature. And you know what sin nature means? That means sin comes naturally. How many of y'all made a resolution to be more sinful this year? Right? I want to try to be a little more greedy this year. Or, I just was a peaceful year last year. I need more anxiety in my life, right? I need to ramp up my anxiety. No, nobody does that because sin comes naturally. Sin comes naturally. That's easy to do. You know, Liam, when he was a little baby, you know, he was in his crib and his diaper was wet and he was hungry and it was like 3 a.m. and he said, oh man, I'm frustrated right now, but you know what? My mom is tired. So I'm just going to wait it out till the morning and let her get her sleep, right? Y'all believe that? No, because sin comes naturally. We are all about ourselves. From the time you're a baby, like one of the first words kids learn, I think, is like mine, 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 right? Because sin comes very naturally to us. But even after like a lot of us have decided to become a Christian, there's still this battle going on, this struggle. So if you're a believer here today, y'all know you still struggle, right? Anybody else besides me still struggle? Yeah, we're all there. And you ever watch those testimonies where people will share their testimony and they'll say, oh, man, I was lost and I was struggling and man, then I found Jesus. And it was all cupcakes and dandelions from then on out, right? It was wonderful from then on out, right? Man, this guy Paul is writing the Bible and he's still struggling, right? So I think we can be in good company here to know that Paul is struggling. It's all good. We're going to struggle, but let's see what we can do with it. So the truth is, I want you to know is that whether you're a Christian or not here today, you are no match for sin. Sin will take you out. Amen? Amen. Amen. y'all get a little quiet here, and I take a lot longer when it's quiet. So if y'all want to like speed it up and get to lunch, you know what I'm talking about? Let's hear some good amens in here. Here we go. But the proof is that we keep on going through the same mistake over and over and over, right? And there's a great verse that has changed my life, and it's kind of a funny verse. That's why it stuck with me. It's from Proverbs, and I wish I knew the reference right now. But the proverb says, as a dog returns to its vomit, so a fool repeats his folly. Y'all ever see a dog eat vomit? That's disgusting. So a fool keeps on doing that same thing over and over. But we've all been there. We all keep repeating these same mistakes. And, well, you know, we'll just need to try harder next time. The problem is that we can't try hard enough and get it all right, right? The problem is you. The problem is ourselves, and ourself is the one we're fighting. Yeah, you know, the self-help industry is like $10 billion a year of self-help books that it gets sold in self-help industry. That's crazy. But the problem with self-help industry is that it relies on self-help, right? But self is the problem. You're the one that got you into the mess. I don't think you're going to be able to help you here. So we're going to try to break up what the solution is to this one problem that you and I both have. So Paul, again, says, what a wretched man I am. What a wretched man I am. Look at the person beside you and say, you wretched. Not ratchet. That's different. Wretched. Says, who will rescue me from this body subject to death? Oh, man, you guys better get ready for an amen, because this is the pinnacle here. Here we go. Thanks be to God who delivers me through who? Jesus Christ, our Lord. Let's just read that whole verse together because, man, this is powerful if somebody gets us here today. Thanks be to God who delivers me through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. Yeah, let's say amen that real quick. Praise God. Come on. Everybody in the lounge, come on. Amen. So the solution to our struggle is not found in us. It's not something we can try harder and take a new approach and try to get this all taken care of. The problem is us. So the solution is Christ. He's going to be the one that delivers us from the battle, but he's also going to be the one that delivers us from the guilt and from the shame that we're battling, right? So the problem, your problem is you, but your solution is Christ. My problem is me. My solution is Christ. That goes in your blank there. All right. Now, this is probably, I said that Romans is like the best verse in the Bible, and that's our best book in the Bible, excuse me. And then the best chapter would be like chapter 8. And the best verse in this chapter is probably verse 1. And this is going to be powerful for somebody. Here we go. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Bam. There's no more condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. If you have decided to put your faith on what Jesus did, now you all know what Jesus did, right? He is God in human form. He came to earth 2,000 some years ago, and he lived a perfect life. He lived a life that you and I could not live, and he died a death that you and I deserved. And he paid the penalty for our sin. And on the third day after he was crucified, he rose again to prove that that payment was sufficient. That payment, the check cleared, and we are all now free. So let's praise God together, because there is no condemnation for what Christ did on the cross. And so now you and I are uncondemnable. You are uncondemnable. We are clean, and God no longer judges you based on your actions. See, a lot of us, I think we feel like God is judging us because of what we have done or what we are currently doing, right? But God does not judge you on your actions anymore, because there is no condemnation. Now, you still may condemn you, right? You know, people that you still condemn yourself. Your heart may condemn you. A judicial system may condemn you, right? A religious system may condemn you. But this is not about religion. This is about a relationship with Jesus Christ. And you are now uncondemnable. Let's see why. Here we go. Because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit who gives life has set you free from the law of sin and death. Now, those two laws, how do you have one law setting you free from another law? How do you have one law take over another law? Well, first of all, let's take a look at this law real quick. Law of sin and death. You ever heard of the law of sin and death? It's really simple, okay? I spoke about it when we talked about break the pattern if you're there for that series. The law of sin and death is that every time you sin, you bring death. Now you say, well, that's crazy. I've never killed anybody, right? It's not always a literal death. Romans 6:23 says the wages of sin is death. We have all sinned though, right? How many of y'all are dead? Right? This is talking about a different kind of death. The word is thanatos, and it means a misery that accompanies sin. So how many of y'all, you know this has happened before where someone has lied in a relationship and the relationship died, right? Or there's some other death. Maybe you stole something and your freedom was died, or your clean conscience has died, or whatever it is. There's always a death that accompanies sin. So whenever you do something, and the law of sin and death says anytime you sin, there it brings forth some kind of death in your life. But this is saying that Jesus brought a new law. The law of the Spirit has given you life and set you free from the law of sin. How can one law overcome another law, right? Well, that's easy, right? I was going to, just got back 2 weeks ago from El Salvador, and awesome time there. And but when we were in the plane, you know what was holding us to the ground, right? Gravity, the law of gravity was holding us to the ground. But then once we started going, the law of motion, the law of inertia ended up taking us and overcame the law of gravity and brought us into the air. Does that make sense? So you can have one law kind of overtake the other law, and that's kind of a picture of what we're doing here. So this new law has set us free from the power of sin and the penalty of sin. It says, for what the law was powerless to do because it was weakened by the flesh. Now this is talking about a different law. This is talking about God's law. It was powerless because it was weakened by the flesh. What does that mean? See, here's what happens when I read this stuff. I got nothing from this. I got lost right here maybe. For what the law, and then I was like, I got another powerless, weakened by the flesh. What are they talking about? Flesh? Like meat or something? You know what I mean? Like, I scratch my head. Anybody else scratch their head when they, I mean, sometimes literally, when you're reading the Bible, it's like, what did I just read? Let me start over and see if I can get it this time, right? I think we're all there, but let's kind of break this down. It says, for what the law was powerless to do, this is God's law, was powerless to do because it was weakened by the flesh. How is God's law weakened by the flesh? Well, it's like any law. If you put a law together and nobody obeys it, don't you kind of weaken that law, right? We got those circles there, the traffic circles up on Horner and Hawkins there, and Hawkins and one there. And there's two traffic circles, but nobody knows that you're supposed to keep going around the circle until you leave, right? You don't stop and let somebody in, right? There, you might have a rule there, but it's weakened by the fact that nobody obeys that, right? Same with the turn signals, right? You know, the law is weakened because you and I can't keep the law. God has put his law out there for us, but we can't keep it. So we kind of have weakened that law. This is why religion doesn't work. It's because it's like, I'm going to try to be a good person. Well, guess what? We're not good people. You can try all you want, but you and I are not good people. Christianity has never been about a bunch of rules. It can't be. Because you and I can't keep those rules. It's about a relationship. See, we are the problem with following a bunch of rules because we can't follow a bunch of rules. See, a lot of times I think that there's a myth here, and I think some of us in this room maybe believe this, that if you do enough good in your life to outweigh the bad in your life, then God will take you into heaven, right? Some of you believe this here today. There's a problem with this, right? Because where on earth do you see this kind of system of justice, right? It's like, where do you do enough good things that you make up for your bad things? Well, Your Honor, my client did shoot that guy in the leg, but he hasn't shot anyone else in the leg, so he should be good to go, right? Right? Or, I defrauded the IRS intentionally this year, but the last 6 years, I've rocked it, man, so I should be good, right? We think we can maybe counterbalance this. So, you know, where's that country where you can go and like, yeah, you can kill people as long as you're nice to them, right? It's like, what? What are you talking about? There doesn't make sense to say that your good can outweigh your bad and stuff like that. That it's completely flawed logic. There's nowhere in life that's true. We shouldn't think that God is the same way. So there's a problem with this law. If it's weak, it can't save us. And if you and I have broken the law at any point, guess what? We're toast. We're separated from God. That's it. But what the law was powerless to do because it was weakened by the flesh, read this with me, God did. Read that again. God did. So what the law could not do, the law could not save us, but God could. How did he save us? Let's take a look. He saved us by sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh to be a sin offering. And so he condemned sin in the flesh in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fully met in us. So God's solution was not, this first law didn't work because we couldn't obey it. So maybe he would just give us another law. No, he sent his son to pay the penalty for our sin, to fulfill the requirement of the law. What's the righteous requirement of the law? What does it mean to be righteous? Not like surfing righteous, dude. What does righteous mean? It means doing it right? Doing it the right way. Well, how do you meet the righteous requirement of any law? What's the righteous requirement of the click it or ticket law? Click it, right? What's the righteous requirement of paying your taxes by April 15th? Paying your taxes by April 15th. What's the righteous requirement of the law? Obedience, full obedience. But none of us can do this. We cannot meet that. So Jesus came, he condemned sin in our flesh, and we're going to give you a little picture of this in just a second, in order that the righteous requirement will be met. So God looks at us in our rebellious state, and he says, you know what, I love them, so I'm going to make a way to stay connected to them. Because every time we sin, we separate ourselves from God, but God sends Jesus to stand in that gap and reunite us with God. Can I get an amen there? Amen. Come on. All right, so he says, I will take on all the sin of anybody who will accept me. And verse 4 says that requirement, that righteous requirement is met because of Jesus. All right, so I'm going to do a little illustration here to kind of explain this a little bit. And if I could get, let's get the same clowns. Where's Flint? Where'd Flinty go? We'll get Flint in here because he's hilarious. And I just need one volunteer. You don't have to say anything. You don't have to do anything fancy. Just one person that will help me illustrate this point. One person that is not so shy. Come on, Justice. Let's see if you can do it justice. All right. So there's a bunch of laws going on here, and this is hard to understand. There's my Flint. All right, and Gary, where are you? There you are. All right, so Justice, why don't you stand back here? All right, and Justice is, and this, don't worry about these being guys and this being a girl here, because this Justice is complicated. I don't know if you knew this. Dad knew this. Justice is complicated. Justice has three parts. She has her body or her flesh, and this flesh, this is the sin nature we talked about. This is a part of all of us. We all have this. And this is under the law of sin and death. He's stuck under the law of sin and death. The second part is this mind, or the soul, as a lot of places refer to it, the mind. And the mind is under the law of good. Paul says, I desire to do what's good. I mean, I want to, I just can't, right? So this is the mind. He's under the law of good. And then this is the spirit. And this is the law of life, and let's have you be sleeping right now, because before someone comes to Christ, this part of them is asleep. It hasn't woken up yet, okay? So there's these parts of the body here, the parts of Justice here. And so now, Justice, let's come up with a conflict here. Let's say you are tempted to sin. Let's see, who can be God's law here? Who wants to be God's law? Somebody just take this. Here you go, Austin. All right, so God's law says do not steal. So go ahead and tell her to not steal.
Do not steal.
Okay, so God's law has told her to not steal. But her mind says, what does your mind say?
Don't steal.
The mind agrees with that. That's a good idea. We should not steal. But I can understand why that would hurt someone else and that would be bad for me. But then there's this other side of us here. This Gary. And the Gary just likes to do what pleases Gary, all right? And so he says doing that, but what does Gary say? He says, no, man, it's all right. Just this one time, you need it, right? They don't really need that thing. You need that thing, right? And so there's this little battle going on, and a lot of you have experienced this battle within yourself between doing what's right, because all of us kind of know what's good, But then our body kind of says, I don't want to do what's right for me. I don't want to submit to this person. I don't want to show humility in this. I want to have a fight. I want whatever. And there's this battle that goes on. Now, who usually wins this battle? The body, a lot of times, it's this flesh. We give in to our flesh. The flesh can overtake because it's so coercive. We justify, we rationalize, and this goes on. Now, Flint's still sleeping here. And Justice, what are we going to do to wake this guy up? Here's what happens in the life of a person. If you decide to wake up your spirit, it's as simple as calling on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible says if you call on the name of Jesus Christ, then you will be saved. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord, then you will be saved. So I want you right now to just confess that Jesus, you are Lord. So go ahead right now and just say, Jesus, you are Lord.
Jesus, you are Lord.
All right, that's not loud enough to wake him up. He's still sleeping. All right. So one more time, come on.
Jesus, you are Lord.
All right, one more time with spirit.
Jesus, you are Lord.
All right, that ought to wake him up. All right. Yes. So the spirit comes alive, makes the mind deaf. The spirit comes alive, and now we have a third part of justice here. And this spirit, are we all good there? So the law of sin and death is struggling over there. So here's what happens now, okay? So you guys don't know each other that well yet. You just met. And that's true. I mean, Flint is not fully exercised. Justice kind of barely even knows he's here yet because he just woke up. She's so used to depending on the mind to direct her where to go and fighting with her flesh. Okay. All right, so now let's get another situation here. Kirby, what's your favorite car? Best car? Best car you've ever driven? Huh?
300Z.
All right, 300Z. So Kirby starts rolling up in a 300Z, and it is so tempting to get a little jealous, to start coveting his 300Z. And I don't even know what that is. But so he's got 300Z, but then God's law comes in and says, what about coveting? Okay, so he says, do not covet, and the mind says?
Do not covet.
All right, and the flesh says? Let's go, baby. I think you're talking about stealing now. Just coveting, I think you should have it. I think you deserve good things, blah, blah, blah. And he puts it on. All right, now, justice is used to relying on the mind, but now there's the spirit here. And so she needs to make sure she relies on him. So justice says, Jesus, can you help me? To kind of let her spirit know that she wants him to be involved. So go ahead.
Jesus, can you help me?
A little louder.
Jesus, can you help me?
Okay. And Jesus comes in and the mind, she is putting her mind with the spirit. And now they are no match for the flesh. All right, kids. Okay, so does that kind of make sense there? That we have three laws going on, actually four laws counting the law of God. And it's not that the law is bad, it's just we can't obey it on our own. But when we invite the Spirit of Christ, or Flint, to come into our lives, to awaken in our lives, now we have a third player. But it doesn't come naturally. We need to train our mind to be connected to the Spirit. Because if we have our mind just, I'm going to go with the way I've always done, you're going to keep fighting these battles. And a lot of us Christians are in that place where you're still fighting battles you should have won a long time ago because you haven't trained your mind to focus on this connection with the Spirit, okay? Exercise that Spirit. There's nothing wrong with the Spirit. It's just sometimes we don't depend on him enough, okay? So let's give these guys a hand. Let me have that paper. We'll leave it here on the seat so we can see. Thank you, sir.
I'm just going to stay here.
You're going to stay here? Get comfortable?
Yeah.
All right, so this is what I'm talking about here. There's three laws going on. And if you get this today, if you understand this today, and I think some of y'all are in this place of your spirit is still sleeping here, so this might be your first step. But here we go. Let's get to this next part here. So your problem is you. Your solution is Christ. But your victory is dependence, depending on God's Spirit in you. Jesus, when he left, he was resurrected to heaven. He said, I have to go because I'm sending someone else. I'm sending a comforter. He's sending his Holy Spirit to live inside of each one of us. So it would have been great if Jesus could stick around longer, But it's much better that he goes, because now we all can have access to his spirit within us. And it will give us the power as we train our mind to beat this law of sin and death because of the law of life. So I want to read this next passage here. And this is, now that we have a visual, I'm a visual person, a visual learner. I have to see it and then I start to get it. So now that we've talked about this visual, as I read this, let's see if this makes more sense. And maybe you want to go home and read some of Romans 2 and see if you can make it make sense with these laws here now that it's a little more clear, I think. Okay, so I'm going to go through this kind of quickly. Just listen along or read along if you'd like. And I know it's kind of small, so maybe the camera could zoom in a little for our lounge folks there. It says, those who live according to the flesh have their minds on what the flesh desires. That's what I talked about. The mind is connected to the flesh. But those who live in accordance with the Spirit have their minds on what the Spirit desires. That makes sense? That makes more sense. You can see it, right? All right. The mind governed by the flesh, so the mind, if the flesh is the boss of the mind, that's death. But the mind governed by the Spirit is life and peace. This is the solution to our struggle right here. The mind governed by the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law, nor can it do so. Okay, so if that relationship goes on and the flesh has its way, we don't like God's law anymore. That's why a lot of people just have trouble with God's law. We don't want to hear about the Bible because our flesh is hostile to God. I feel like I'm ringing a little bit, Eric, am I? All right. Those who are in the realm of the flesh cannot please God. It's impossible to please God because you're living in the flesh rather than living in faith. Without faith, you cannot please God. Verse 9 says, you, however, are not in the realm of the flesh, but are in the realm of the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God lives in you. In other words, you have decided to wake up your spirit. You have said, Jesus, can you help me? Jesus, you are my Lord and my Savior. I want you in my life. You woke up that spirit, and now you're no longer in the realm of the flesh. You're in the new realm, if indeed the Spirit of God lives in you. And if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, they do not belong to Christ. If you've never woken up this, you're not a Christian. I'm sorry. I don't mean to burst your bubble, but if you do not live in the Spirit, the same, if the Spirit is not alive in you, it's not awake, then it just, you're disconnected from Christ right now. And if you're in that place, I want to say, awesome, you picked a great service to be here, and I want to give you an opportunity to wake up that person in your life. It says, but if Christ is in you, then even though your body is subject to death because of sin, the Spirit gives life because of righteousness. So now God sees you. You are righteous and perfect because Jesus already paid the penalty for your sin, and the Spirit has now given you life. And we'll close with this. And if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies because of his Spirit who lives in you. So now when God sees you, he sees the Spirit alive in you, and he will raise you to life because he has deposited his Spirit in you. So I want to just give you three quick things, because I think we say, yeah, be dependent on the Spirit. That's easy to say, but how? How do you depend on the Spirit? What do you even do? And I'm just going to take what Paul said and see if we can break it down. All right, first thing, live according to the Spirit. Other versions say walk by the Spirit. Well, how do you walk by something, right? If I walk by a walker, I have a walker here, and I'm leaning on it. I'm depending on this walker to go through life. In the same way, we need to depend on the Spirit in every circumstance. We need to walk by the Spirit. Those who live do not live according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit, from Romans 8. The second thing you can do is invite God's Spirit to dwell in you. Set your mind on what the Spirit desires. So start setting your mind on what the Spirit desires. Those who live in accordance with the Spirit have their minds set on what the Spirit desires. So what does the Spirit desire? How are we going to know what the Spirit desires, right? You got to get to know the Spirit. You got to wake him up in your life. You got to put your mind on that. And a little bit later in this chapter, Romans chapter 12, verse 1, it says, do not be conformed by the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. In other words, you got to fix your mind. You got to decide. You have control. A lot of times we don't have control over the flesh, but you have control over your mind, and you can start doing things that will put your mind in a good place. For example, get around some godly people. Get involved in a small group. That will start to fix your mind on those things. Bible says also, you know, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is wholesome, and all those things, fix your mind on that. Put your mind on those things. We have to have the mind of Christ, another place says, you know. Songs get stuck in your head, right? How many of y'all know, like a million lyrics of a rap song? I mean, there's some of these kids impress me because they know so many lyrics to rap songs, and that's a lot of words in those rap songs, right? Y'all know kids that just can roll them right out. If we instead put God's word in that, or if we get some Christian music and we start singing those songs and get those songs stuck in our head, the situation changes, right? So now when I'm facing a situation of tempted to be angry and to be to lash out in anger with someone, and then I start thinking, Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need you. Right? If we start singing those things and getting God at the center of that, and the bridge of that song says, so teach my song to rise to you when temptation comes my way. And when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Because Jesus, you're my hope and stay. And if you sing that and you're facing a situation, you're basically saying what Justice said. God, I need you. Every hour I need you. And you're telling the Spirit, you're inviting your mind to be united with the Spirit. And then that's how you defeat the devil. That's how you defeat your flesh. Does that make sense? Maybe you don't know how to sing or whatever, but you can recite a verse or something like that. But it starts in the mind. You tell your mind where to go. All right, last thing, invite God's Spirit to dwell in you. In other words, let's wake him up. And if he's already awake, let's wake him up some more. Let's get him more active in your life. You, however, are not in the realm of the flesh, but you are in the realm of the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God lives in you. So God's Spirit is available to all of us if we would just invite him to wake up. I want to close. We're going to have Chautauqua sing a song in just a moment, but if you just bow your heads with me, I want to talk to God together and just kind of give you another word picture before we close here. And I want you just in your own mind, I want you to imagine a scenario for me. Think about your favorite sports team, or your favorite musician, something like that. And I want to give you backstage passes. I want to give you backstage passes to that for free. Just take them. And you get backstage passes. And you get in there to the concert or to the game or whatever it is. And man, all the food's included. All this great stuff. Man, you get autographs after. It's just an awesome experience. And all you had to do was say, yes, I offered you something free. You took it. And you got a whole lot more than you thought you were going to get because you got all the included stuff in there. Man, what an awesome thing that is. Now, let's say you try to go in there the next night to another concert, or the same concert, repeated, or same game, or whatever, another game. And you'd say, well, I had the pass last time, so I should be good. I earned my way in here. I think you're going to get kicked out, right? You don't have the pass. The thing that makes you qualified to come in, to enter in, is not something you've done. It's not because you're the biggest fan or anything else like that. The person at the gate is going to say, do you have a ticket? And at the end of your life, the end of my life, we're going to come to God, and he's going to say, do you got the ticket? He's not going to say, all right, let's see how many good things you did, how many bad things you did. He's got, I got so many great things in store for you. Did you just accept that free gift when it was offered to you? Did you just simply take it? Or did you think well, I can work harder, and I don't want to just take something for free. That's silly, you know. I want to work for it, something like that. God is offering you this free gift. And you're right, you don't deserve to be there. But because of Jesus, because of what he did, he paid the penalty, he paid the price of admission, so you can now have a relationship with God and you can join him for all eternity. So this morning, think about where you are with God. I think there's a couple categories of people. There are people that have woken up their spirit, and they are learning more and more how to get their mind to depend on the Spirit day to day. And I want to encourage you to keep pressing, keep pressing. We will never be exactly like Jesus, but we can keep pushing towards that goal of becoming more Christ-like, because God can use you more when you're dependent on his Spirit. There's a second category of people, those who have woken up the Spirit, but man, the Spirit's kind of just chilling there. He's getting sleepy too because you haven't called on him. And then you notice some of these battles in your life. You're fighting yourself. The flesh is winning a lot of the times too. And it's just frustrating because God has meant you for so much more. He has promised life and peace. But you're just stuck in the mud fighting this battle with yourself. Call on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Call on him to help you. Lord, I need you. Every hour I need you. And then there's a third category of people in here today. In this category, you haven't ever woken up the Spirit, and that's okay. I want to invite you today to do that, to accept this free gift of salvation that God has offered to you. He's given you a ticket. He said, here's your ticket. You going to take it or you're just going to leave it? God has so much in store for you. Would you just call on him today? Awake the Spirit in your life. Now, a lot of times we tell people to raise their hands or come up to the front or something like that. This is a very personal decision, but there is something powerful about just speaking out, accepting with your mouth, just saying, God, I need you. Would you be my Lord and Savior? So I want to just first, and this is up to you guys, what you want to do. If you're in the category of that second person that you say, I'm fighting too many of battles myself, I'm not relying on the Spirit, would you just slip up your hand? I want to pray for you right now. I'm fighting myself. I've got some battles going on, and I can't win on my own. I need to call on the Spirit more. I see those hands. That's right. Let me pray for you right now. Father God, right now, would you just give the Holy Spirit in their lives, God, an energy drink or something. God, would you help them to call on the Spirit, to help the Spirit to be more active? God, would you help them to train their minds to depend on the Spirit and no longer depend on their flesh? God, would you just give us a renewed mind, God, that we wouldn't get stuck in the old battles, God, but we would see what your will is, because I know that you have a plan and a purpose for each one in this room, God, to do awesome things. But if we get stuck in our own battles, God, how can you use us anymore? So God, I pray for each one that they would be encouraged to rely on your Spirit in every situation. Now, how many here would be bold enough to say, you know, this is me. I have never decided to wake up the Spirit in my life. But today might be the day. Today's the day. I need to wake up the Spirit. Just slip your hand up. I won't call you out. I'll barely look at you. If you want to accept the Holy Spirit in your life, you want to say, God, your Spirit needs to come alive in me for the first time because I want to rely on that Spirit. Anybody here in the lounge want to do that, in the party room? I want to accept this free gift, this free ticket. And I want to say, I don't want you to come up front. I don't want you to do anything. But after the service, if you come and meet with me, I would love to pray with you and help the Spirit wake up inside of you. We had a young lady do that on Thursday, and it was such a blessing to see that change in her life already. So let's just, let me close this in prayer, and then Chautauqua is going to sing a song that kind of echoes what I've been talking about here. And then we'll close the service. Father God, I thank you for each one here. And I pray that each of us would be encouraged not only to rely on your Spirit, God, but to dig into your word, to see it with a new lens, God, to be hungry for what your will is, God, in our lives, Lord. Help us to be diligent in pursuing you in all situations, Lord. God, forgive us for when we failed. We thank you for Jesus who makes that possible. Amen.
I am guilty, ashamed of what I've done, what I've become. My hands are dirty. I dare not lift them up to the Holy One. Love me, but in